So Eric's got a company that he's gonna start, it's gonna call it Cyber Secure, because he doesn't want people to hack into his information, because he's got the Big Brother thing going on. Angela is hanging out, she's a techie, but not quite as successful as Eric is. So Eric starts his company, Cyber Secure, and within no time, you know, he's up to $50 million in revenue after a year. He's doing fantastic, you know, and everybody's excited because he's protecting their information, a la Apple, and not giving up information to the government. Angela sees that, and she's like, I was in class there at Nichols, he's not that smart. I think I can figure this out. So she starts, a company called, not Cyber Secure, Cybersecurity, let's say, okay? And she goes out and markets it and says, oh yeah, we've been in the market for years, you've heard of Cyber Secure, right? That's kind of us, whatever, and starts doing work out there. She has worked for some big company. CEO of the company is on a business trip, and his information is stolen by somebody because the software she has is not as good, right, as Eric's stuff is at Cyber Secure. So the next day, something comes out in the press and says, Cyber Secure, failed CEO, lost millions of dollars, even though it's cybersecurity, right? So what's the first thing Eric's going to do?
Sue Cybersecurity.
You're damn straight he is, right? He's like, this is not my fault. I didn't do anything. I had a successful company, right? So what's going on here? So in a case like that, they would hire us to come in. Eric hopefully would, because he likes us, right? hopefully he would. To say, listen, I need you to do a damage analysis for me. I had $50 million of revenue, and now it dropped $25 million of revenue because people think it was me, when really it was Angela, that dope I had in class with me. Not a dope at all, right? who's really tearing me apart here. And so we'd have to do a pretty complex analysis to say, here's a projection of where Eric would have been over time. His revenues would have gone up to $100 million. Here are the profits he would have had as he grew. Here's what the loss was over that period of time, because he's going to be a while to catch back up and get there again. Right, so we actually have to go to court, prepare an actual report, and then eventually go to court and testify as to what damages we had to sure recoup his funds. So that's an example. All right? So, I stole your thunder there, but.
It's all right. It's a good example.
I try.
White collar defense, so intellectual property disputes. Does anyone know what that means? Have you heard that before yet?
It's like any like copyrights or any like personal information.
We have one in there?
In here, maybe later today. Intellectual property where if the person was leaving the company, before they left, they kind of took all the different, trade secrets, if you will, their the into the company. And so when they left, they
there
had,
is.
Here. You had all the intellectual property. And so that would be one of the disputes where kind of similar, so maybe Angela worked with Ralph. Angela worked with Eric, and before she split into her cybersecurity group, and she ended up taking all, his secure codes and methods. So that would be intellectual property. She ended up leaving and starting her own company using that same kind of information.
Just pulling that out.
And then data analytics. So this is an interesting one. This is kind of what we talked about we have a lot of data. So these companies have all this data, and maybe you're trying to analyze. So someone said there's an allegation that the CFO is, artificially inflating their revenue. Well, how do we find that out? Besides, maybe looking through email and other methods, wouldn't one method be to kind of look at their data and see what's happening with their revenue? Is it actually going up? Is it truly going up? Does their data match what they have in their financial statements? That's kind of this data analytics piece, is taking all this data and doing some analytics or, SQL queries or what have you on it to be able to kind of pinpoint and kind of trend out different trends in the data and see what's going on with it.
This makes our job tremendously efficient. Can date myself, but when I first started doing investigations, if I had an allegation around revenue recognition, for example, and someone said they did bad deals at the end of the quarter, right? I'd have to go into the file in accounting that had the paper copies of invoices, and I'd have to go through and start going through the packages of information to say, is there a problem with this transaction, right, to a bunch of them. Now what I can do is I can actually have my data analytics team link into the actual data within the company and pull all kinds of factors out and say, okay, I want to know every transaction that was in the last 10 days of the quarter that was more than $1 million, that was shipped within New England or whatever, right? Whatever factor I want to come up with, here are the 10 transactions that I really need to look at as a starting point. It makes a big, big difference in what we do. And we'll have a good case example later where we did something similar.
Do we all know what litigation support services is now? Don't get about
ready for the quiz? Everybody's good?
So then forensic accounting, forensic technology, and this data analytics, this is all part of our forensic investigation tools. So these three are kind of what makes up a lot of our bids, our groups work and practice. Okay. Who are our clients? So we had said, well, I think you said that earlier, right? That it would be someone who, it would be a company who's maybe facing sort of litigation or someone going after them. Okay, so it kind of falls into our companies here, and then also lawyers, maybe somebody going after. So you said if you're a shareholder in the company and they do something wrong and you're suing them, your lawyer might help some hire litigation support service to help you look into it. So individuals, same thing. Maybe instead of getting a lawyer, you just hire someone, or, you know, smaller example, if you're going through, like, a divorce, maybe. Maybe you want litigation support to help you with your divorce matters to try to figure out some of your financials. Okay. And privilege. Has anyone ever heard the term privilege before when it comes to litigation?
And it's not spelled wrong, just so you know. When I first started doing this work, I actually was like, no, you spelled that wrong. I remember telling the partner, no, that's wrong, there's a D in there. Well, we'll explain it in a second. Anybody know what it is?
It's like the stuff that's kept private.
Yeah.
And can only be available with certain people, or?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
You get it right.
Yeah.
Don't hesitate, you get it right.
So, have you ever heard the phrase attorney-client privilege? Talk shows and
people
like that.
All right.
So, what does attorney-client privilege mean? Yeah.
Like, even if a client admits they did the crime, the lawyer doesn't have to say anything.
Exactly.
Kind of
almost like a circle of trust, right? Like, you're there and you tell your lawyer if you admit to something, that lawyer isn't allowed to tell anybody else. And so, the litigation support services, if they're working with a law firm, or the law firm hires them, that work that they're doing on behalf of the law firm, that falls under this attorney-client privilege. So this gets really important when it comes to maybe you're in court and you're arguing across something, because if your forensic accountant found something that's wrong, right, maybe you did commit this fraud, well, they don't necessarily have to tell the court that. Or they're not allowed to tell the court that. That's the attorney-client privilege. That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, that can put you in a tight spot too, though. Right? So let's imagine that I'm an expert in court, right, for something, and I know the company did something wrong, and they're telling me I'm not allowed to talk about it, right? But I get direct questions from a judge or somebody. What do I do in that instance? So that's where we have to work with our clients to say, listen, here's a risk, right, in certain cases. If we get to a forum where we have to give that information, then we will. And we're always advising our clients as to the circumstances that may arise like that so that we don't get ourselves in trouble. Most of the times when we do investigations in particular, we're going to find bad things, actually going to find bad things. And so lots of times folks are in front of a regulator like the SEC or someone else, And we have to tell them, listen, this is bad stuff. Here's how you should present it to the SEC. And they may say, you know what, no, no, we're not going to do that. But that's just like an auditor, in a way. It's my job to say, well, if you're not going to come forward with the SEC and come forth and tell them what they need to know, then I need to step away and not be on this engagement, right? And so we've had those types of situations before because the client wants us to step up and say, oh, Ernst & Young said it's okay. Tony Jordan said it's okay. And that's not where I want to be, right? So I've got to tell them, nope. We have to come out and tell the truth if we're going to do it. Otherwise, you know, I'm going to walk away. Now, they still have that protection that I found these bad things and they can do with it what they want, but at least I've separated myself from it. So that while that privilege is a protection for them, you have to be very careful as a professional to make sure that you're doing the right thing by yourself because your reputation, you know, is extremely important. So. And I've had that because I worked with the SEC, so sometimes people want me to go to the SEC and say, hey, it's okay because those guys all know me. Right, and I had one case in particular where that happened, where someone said, "Go say this for us," and I said, "Well, they know me, and if I come out and say that way, they're going to say that's not Tony. You know, they know that's not me, and they know that's a lawyer speaking. And I can't do that." So we do find ourselves in tricky positions sometimes. Yeah.
Work product.
Well, I mean, that's the other privilege always applies. Like an attorney doesn't have to share with the other attorneys his like thoughts and reflections upon the case. You know, make a lot of sense when you think about it. I think my client's guilty. Yeah. I have a bunch of notes about that. And so a lot of our work is protected by kind of the same doctrine. In addition to the attorney, it's his paralegals, the experts they hire, any kind of work that the attorney is planning as part of the strategy of the case is protected by the work product doctrine. So.
Under that same thing. So how many times, like, have you written a paper before and you just use one draft? Really? You don't use multiple drafts? Go through and edit it? That makes sense. To me, I write something, I just kind of spit it all out and then go back to it like a couple hours later and kind of clean it up, fix it, make sure it says what I want it to say. So in that instance, you know, I only want my final draft to be seen. I don't want anyone to see my first draft, right? I might not be making sense, I might be saying something incorrectly, but that kind of also covers it too, where if I'm maybe delivering something to the court or delivering something to the lawyers, it's only going to be my final draft that's kind of discoverable, my first draft sculpted.
Yeah, if you think about some of the reports that we're doing, like I just had an 85-page report, there's lots of drafts of that, right? 85 pages. There's no way I'm getting it right the first time.
Alright. So who performs litigation support services? So types of firms and companies, accounting firms. Have you guys heard of the Big Four? Mm-hmm. Okay. So EY's in the Big Four. Public companies, FTI, Navigant, and then boutique firms, smaller investigative firms, which Tony was at before he came over to EY. And who we employ, accountants, finance professionals, economists, information technology specialists, former law enforcement. One of my colleagues, I'm on a project down in Texas. He's a former FBI special agent. So he has a story where he got to do the battering ram, like when they're chasing after a guy. So he got to batter ram the door down, and he said he just sat there and took pictures on his cell phone afterwards, after they caught him back.
Was that?
Keith Allen.
Oh.
Allen Bell.
Yeah.
So they, you know, we work with former law enforcement people who have some fun stories, and then the lawyers. So how is forensic accounting different than auditing? So we touched on it a little bit earlier. We'll kind of dive into it a little bit more. So timing, how often does an audit occur?
Annually?
Yeah, annually, maybe some of you do some quarterly work too. But you kind of know every single year you're going to get one done, right? Mm-hmm. So what about a forensic investigation? Are you going to, you know, do you know every December you're going to be at that company doing an investigation? So auditing, it's recurring. Forensic investigation, non-recurring. meaning it's not going to keep popping up every year. You have to find new projects, or hopefully the company doesn't have an audit or investigation every year.
You hope.
Okay.
Did you have a question? Oh, I thought you raised your hand.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Okay. So scope, we think we talked about this earlier too. When you're going to do a financial audit, what are you looking at? The financials, yeah. You're kind of going in with like a general view, right? What about an investigation? What are you going in and looking for? What's the scope of your work?
Much more specific.
Yeah, exactly. So general, specific. Got it. So objective. What's the end goal of an audit?
Just make sure that you're in compliance.
Yeah, and then if it is, what do you do?
What if that is?
Yeah, you issue. Exactly. You issue an opinion on it. So, what's the end goal of investigation?
Put someone in jail.
Yeah. And catch the bad guy.
Sorry. I get excited about this stuff. I'm sorry.
Catch the bad guy. Yeah, issue your opinion, confirm, determine if there's intent in there, quantify the issue. Relationship. How do you think auditors' relationships are with their clients?
They
kind of get along?
Yeah, they know their clients. They don't actually, don't have a tight relationship. They work with each other every day, but they know each other.
Yeah, so they're probably kind of friendly a little bit. Okay. What about if you're doing an investigation?
Don't you want to keep a distance between the two, just so there's no bias information or anything like that?
Yeah. So let's say we're trying to talk to the guy who committed the fraud, or allegedly committed the fraud. Do you think it's going to be very nice when we start asking him questions about it? Potentially. Maybe it will be nice, not realize.
We'll think of some good storytelling around that at some point. A few people have invited me over time.
Audit techniques.
Audit techniques, yes. Audit techniques, I didn't mean it.
Quick.
Okay, and then what's your methodology for forensic investigation?
Just make sure. Looking at all the financials and technology and anything else coincide with the case. So.
Yeah, you're kind of using the specific allegations and learning what you find out throughout the way, kind of guide what you're going to do, right? And that's an interesting point here on the bottom is, so audit techniques, you kind of have a checklist, right, that you're going through. Does the cash reconcile to the bank statements? Cutoff testing, did we do that? Whereas a forensic investigation, no one commits fraud the same way. So there's not a checklist that you got to go through to find how the person did it. And then presumption. So what are you thinking? What do you do when you go into an audit? What are you thinking about when you go in?
You should always be skeptical.
Yeah.
So you just try to judge everything with the rest of that.
Exactly. You kind of trust or verify. Trust what they're saying, but you're also going to back it up and look for it yourself. Professional skepticism. What about in an investigation?
Do you assume it's wrong? And you look for how it is wrong?
Yeah, so this is a... So it's kind of, all right, something's not right here. Let's try to find where it is and, if it really is wrong or not.
Yeah, we get involved in so many cases where, if you think about today, everybody's heard of whistleblowers, right? It's all over all the time. The FCC's got a whistleblower program. Department of Justice has a whistleblower program. And so when we get an allegation, we often have to try and figure out, is it a valid allegation or not? Because the company's trying to file their financial statements or do something, and it's holding them up from doing that and filing their financials, et cetera. So we have to pretty quickly come up with a plan to say, is it real, right? And so I'll give you just a really easy example. So we had a company that sold a certain type of appliances. The appliance was about this big, right? And they had someone send a letter to them and their auditor right near the end of a quarter when they were about to file their financial statements. And they said, we have reason to believe that, you know, we talked to truckers and this, that, and the other, and the company moved $50 million of inventory off-site to hide it from the auditors, right? Wow, it's a big problem, isn't it, right? But as a forensic accountant, I say, okay, I get my arms around this, how am I going to do it? And first thing that we did, because the company's trying to file their financials literally in a week from then, so I had 1 week to try and figure out if this is a valid allegation, right, or not. If it's valid, then they probably got to hold up filing their financials, which tells the market that they have a problem, right? So how are we going to do this? And you got to take it seriously. So we said, okay, $50 million worth of stuff, what is that? So, okay, one of these things is about $100, right? Well, that's $100. How many of those does it take to get $50 million worth, right? Divide, figure it out, this many units. All right, fine. And then I said, okay, the company doesn't even own their own trucks. They don't own a single truck. They actually have FedEx ship everything and use another company, right? So I said, okay, if I took this, how many fit in a standard truck? And we figured out it would take 45 trucks to move $50 million worth of inventory, right? So how might you figure out if somebody used 45 trucks to move inventory? Yeah, look at expenses for what? You got there part way, yeah? Expenses for what?
The rent for the trucks.
Yeah, for trucks and things like that, right? So I looked at every invoice with FedEx, every invoice with UPS, every invoice for a trucker, right? Is there any evidence they have 45 trucks come through here? No, there's none, right? And went through all that information, went through the warehouse, went through inventory reports to see if stuff had moved out. Because if stuff moved, they have to track where it's going all the time, right? Whether it's somebody's thing, it's shipping docs, or a piece of paper or something, we'll look at that. And so we did enough work like that to say, nope, not a problem, somebody's making this up completely, and we were able to tie it to a whole longer story. We were tied to somebody who was very obsessed with the company and trying to make them look bad to figure it out. But at the end of the day, they didn't have a problem. So sometimes we get involved in stuff where there's no problem at all. But we have to begin with, it does smell like crap, right? And how do we figure that out? So.
What they're saying here. Give me a minute to read. All right. So what are they doing here? Just a fraud.
Yeah, that's a fraud. That would definitely be fraud.
Yep. So what they're doing is they're taking not real inventory, shipping it out so that they can count it as revenue.
Okay. If you put the gum on, is that okay? Does that make it stick together?
Yeah, holds all right. It all together. All right. Yeah. Right. Not allowed. Not
allowed.
Probably not good. An issue there. Okay, and then has anyone heard about this tenant healthcare? This came out. This $513 million fine that they have to pay just came out like a couple weeks ago.
Have you
heard about it?
Yeah. Is that the one, I forget what it was, was some medication, I want to say Medifen AIDS medication or something that, I know it was before, I heard it before a while ago, but it was, they were getting $5,000 or $6,000 kickbacks every time they prescribed it, so it just jacked up the price, and people that didn't even need it, they just prescribed it to them and give them like other pills.
Yeah, you're like halfway there with it, about half. So what they were doing is they would be going to these these clinics where undocumented women would go for, and say they were pregnant, and they would tell these women the only way we'll cover your health insurance and having your baby will be covered is if you go to these tenant hospitals, or tenant healthcare clinics or hospitals. That's the only way, because Medicaid will cover it, but that Medicaid won't cover it if they go to another hospital. So these clinics were sending people to these tenant hospitals where they would do the work, charge Medicaid, and then they would send a kickback to those clinics. So those clinics were getting money for making these women go to these certain hospitals.
And what kind of money were they getting? Government money.
Government money.
If you're going to defraud somebody, don't defraud the government. They get really angry. They'll put you in jail. honestly, if you actually did this to a company, you might be okay. I'll tell another story in a minute about that, because they might not actually go after you for all kinds of reasons, which I'll get into in a second.
So if it's government money, they're going to go after you.
Yeah. Not that you should steal from anybody money.
So this first one is an example of financial statement fraud. Right there. They're artificially inflating their revenue, they're channel stuffing, trying to get it all in before the end of the year. And then this one is occupational fraud, kickbacks, bribery, corruption, kind of all falls in this occupational fraud.
All right, financial statement fraud. And I will tell you just a really quick story before I get into this, right? So to give you a sense as to what I was talking about with individuals and companies and government and all that fun stuff, right? So I had a case several years ago now. I was at Arthur Anderson. Rest in peace, Arthur Anderson. And we had these events we do called Power Breakfast. And we pull all kinds of clients and do these things. We did a big hotel, ballroom, and we'd have somebody come in and CEO of a company and do a big presentation, right? So one of our clients who was there said, hey, I saw this guy, JP, we'll say for a minute, this is JP Hamlin, by the way, saying, JP, I saw him here. Is he at one of your audit clients? The audit partner said, I don't know, let me go look, and he looked at the list on the table. Yeah, JP's the head of internal audit at so-and-so company. I said, great. Well, thought you might want to know, and he stole about $200,000 from us when he worked for us. I said, oh, well, this is a problem, right? But you know what? We were getting ready to go public, and we didn't want out in the press that we had one of our employees steal $200,000, so we just, took his 401k away and told him to leave, and off JP went, right? So now we've got a guy who's a known fraudster sitting at one of our audit clients as the head of internal audit. So they tell me, they say, hey, Tony, can you please go up to this company and do an investigation? But you have to pretend you're part of the audit team so he doesn't know what you're doing. Big brother. So I go in and I wait until the end, till nighttime when he's leaving his desk and I'm looking at some other things. And first thing I do is he's right-handed, right top-hand drawer. Let me look at that. Open up the drawer. All kinds of things where he's got overdue payments, all kinds of stuff going on. Find enough information, long story short, to show that he was stealing some money from the company here and there. Company said, we don't want to spend money on a big, massive investigation. We're just going to let him go, right? So they fired him. Fine. Second company he's been fired from. We know he's stolen from both places. Nobody knows this, right? I would move on. I go do an investigation at a big company. Had a massive problem, about $200 million revenue recognition problem. Just big fraud. And they decided as part of that they need to bring in a head of internal audit. And so they asked me, because the CEO and CFO got to know me really well, they said, Tony, can you please interview the finalists for this job? I said, sure, I'd be happy to. And they gave me four names. Sure enough, one of the four names is the same freaking guy, right? And I said, now, remember the privilege thing we talked about? So I said to the CFO, I said, listen, I said, this JP, I've seen him before. And I look at him and he says, I get it, Tony. I got it. He said, so he's off the list? And can I do this? Okay, he's off the list. So now this guy was going from place to place to place, perpetrating frauds, and no one ever went after him. So the point of the story is, never, just because it's not in someone's background doesn't mean they haven't done it before. So when you have, suspicions that get raised, et cetera, don't assume that somebody hasn't done it before. Alright? So, real quickly, types of fraud we talked about, financial statement fraud, occupational fraud. The main difference is financial statement fraud is typically manipulating the books and records for some reason, right? Making them incorrect. Sometimes it's done for personal gain. So someone's getting a bonus. The personal gain could be that they get to keep their job, frankly. So CFO says to somebody, go ahead, book that. Book that entry. And you're saying, I really don't want to. I'm going to fire you if you don't, right? Well, maybe I'll do it. Now, you shouldn't, by the way. Lots of people get in those situations, unfortunately. But sometimes people do it for job security as well. They have to do it. I have a poor guy who just got sent to federal prison for 2 years for that very reason, because he went along with the fraud. often it's difficult for a company to recover from the situation because what happens is, let's say, you know, let's say you had two legitimate companies, Angela and Eric had two legitimate cybersecurity companies that were fighting against each other for market share, right? Well, if I had a choice, and they're both really good, and I hear great thing about Angela's company, great thing about things about Eric's company, but I find out that Angela's company is going through some really big fraud thing. It's all over the paper. She's got some fraud going on in her company because people stole money and whatnot. I don't know if Angela's going to be here a year from now, so what if I need service or something? Well, same kind of quality product, I better go to Eric instead because I don't know, right? So what happens is companies start to have difficulties because their customers leave, their best employees leave because they're going to say, you know what? I'm the head of sales for Angela's company, and now the sales are going down, and I'm losing my money, my bonuses and everything. Well, Eric's calling me up and saying, hey, can you come over here? You know, you still get your bonuses. And that's, you know, so I might leave there. So all those different reasons.
I'm going to jump in. So project I'm working on right now, it's a financial restatement. So the company hasn't filed financial statements since Q2 2014.
What's wrong with that?
Not doing when you're a public company. So they've been delisted from the stock exchange. But how it kind of all started and why it's taking so long for them to get their books and records straight was, well, it's all different pieces. One of the pieces was they had a strict, they only wanted to write off, I think it was like less than 10% of all their sales. So, you know, bad debt expense, someone can't pay it, you're going to write it off. You guys know what I'm talking about? Okay. So that was the issue. They wanted to have it like less than 10% of all their revenue. And so right around what happens, right around kind of quarter end or year end, if they were flirting with that 10%, they would just say, oh, we gave them a discount. So they would just move it to like above into the like revenue line, contra revenue account. So instead of taking it down here, they're taking it up here. So they kept doing this. And then it got so that it looked like they were giving these huge discounts to people and not writing off anything. But everyone at the company was like, this is great. We're all getting all these big bonuses because we're below our 10% write-off threshold. So that's one piece of a lot of pieces to this. But that's kind of how it all started. And, you know, you read emails with them saying, oh, don't write that off. Just pretend, you know, just say they didn't have a discount right up front. And just bring it down to zero.
Always fun cases. Occupational fraud. Almost always for personal monetary gain, stealing money from the company, typically. There are other examples we won't get into right now, but typically taking money from the company for your own personal gain. I've had instances where people have taken money to buy a boat. I've had instances where people have taken money to buy houses and cars. You know, we've had very big cases. We've had smaller cases. People will steal money for just about anything. So you can count on that part of it. If there's a will, there's a way. It can have a material effect on the reporting of the financial statements because typically somehow to mask the money they were taking out, they had to call it something else. So either they're hiding it and capitalizing it on the balance sheet somewhere, or they're putting it through other expenses that they're really not those kinds of expenses. So it can have an effect on the financial statements. And clearly, again, back to my earlier story where someone didn't want to talk about it or go after somebody because it might get in the press, that can affect investor confidence, right? So if GE came up tomorrow and said, you know what, someone just stole $200 million from us, you might be a little worried about that if you were an investor, right? So it can affect investor confidence. All right, so we talked a little bit about the structure, right? So how do I get started? I talked a little bit about starting with the allegation, right? I talked about the example where I have all those things that allegedly were shipped out. Start with that. I'm going to start with that, and I'm going to figure out when I'm going to look at it. I want to know who my audience is, right? It could be that I am dealing just with the company and the CFO, and the board of directors are trying to explain to them what happened, or I know that a regulator is coming around the corner, the SEC wants to investigate this. And so it's very important that I think ahead as to who might be seeing the information that I'm pulling together. Because how rigorous of an investigation, how I document that, is going to depend on that. Okay. What are the controls and processes around the area? Anybody know why I need to know that? Any idea? Yeah?
I mean, it's kind of like what you just said, how they have to be under like a 10% write-off,
mm-hmm.
and they don't do that. They
mm-hmm.
instead write it as a discount.
Yep.
Like that.
Yeah, so how would I know what? what to look for if I didn't know what controls were around that 10% number, right? Right? So, in every case, I go in, and I pretend I'm really stupid. It's not that hard to do. So, the first thing that I need to do in every one of these cases is you have to remember, I'm investigating somebody who works at a company every single day. You think they know how to hide stuff? Absolutely, right? So I have to know those systems and processes just as well, if not better than they do. So I can figure out how am I going to construct my investigation, right? So every company I go into, I go in, and especially if it's something around the accounting, I say, okay, revenue recognition allegation, I had a company that made this really sophisticated laser equipment, right? One of the two biggest manufacturers of this stuff, and they make these big million-dollar machines that cut microchips for different LED TVs and all kinds of other equipment, right? And they sell them to all the big manufacturers, Samsung and others. And so, allegation that the revenue recognition was done wrong for all kinds of technical reasons. And so I said, okay, you know what I want you to do? I want you to take me through the factory and show me how it's made. And the guy from the accounting goes, no, you don't need to do that. I said, I absolutely need to know that. And so as I'm going through the factory and seeing how it's made, the engineers start telling me, oh, the salespeople always tell us we got to include this, that, and the other, and we can't even do that. Right? And so I'm like, okay, thank you. It's very helpful. I understand that now. And then I start asking questions along the way. Anybody, the shipping area, anybody in? Anybody ever tell you anything odd, like to ship something out in a weird way or anything like that? Oh, yeah. End of every quarter, they tell me to take this stuff, put it on the edge of the dock over there, and put it over that line, because when you put it over the line, it goes to revenue, and then, like a week or two later, they tell me to put it back. Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. Thank you very much, right? And so, those are the types of conversations, I learned about all those things in that process, but I also learned about all the controls. So I say, what documentation is there, right? What's the process supposed to work like? So where are the holes, potentially, in the processes? Who's involved in those controls and processes, right? And where are those potential breakdowns that could occur, right? That's where I learned so much more doing that process, just walking through it, than I would ever by sitting at my desk and asking a bunch of questions and not getting those answers, right? And that helps me trying to craft into it, if there was a fraud, what would it look like, right? So in that 10% example, I might look at it and say, what it would look like is it's always 10%. Every single period is exactly 10%. How the hell is that possible, right? Why is it not 9.4% in one period, 7.3% in another? Why is it always 10%? It wouldn't look like that, that's for sure. So 10%, that's a problem. It's always the same. What other information is available for me to analyze? We do all kinds of things. We talked about email, talked about data. There's also what we call business intelligence, okay? In some cases, if I think that JP's stolen a bunch of stuff, right, and I don't know how he did it, I might start doing some background searches to find out what addresses are related to JP. Who are his relatives? What are their addresses, right? Because now I go into the system, and I see that there were checks sent to his mother's address to the tune of $50 million from the company. Well, why the hell is JP's mother getting $50 million in checks, right? I don't know, but it's probably something I want to look at. So business intelligence is very important, right? Accounting records, blah, 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 blah. Pretty basic stuff.
Google, too. Yeah.
Google is good.
You can find a lot of stuff on Google.
No, well, on the web in general.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, not even just Google, but
yeah.
We were doing one investigation where they thought, kind of shorten it down, they thought the company was bribing foreign officials, like sending them iPads in exchange for them buying product from them. So they sent them free iPads, free TVs, whatever. So part of what we did is we got the addresses that they were shipping all these things to, and we put it into like Google Maps and did Street View on it. Does this look like a house? Does this look like a commercial building? What does this look like? And one of the things we found was a lot of these free TVs and iPads were all going to a person's home, not going to the company as part of the package deal like they said it was.
Yeah, that's there all the time, right? We had a case last year where a company had a number of things that they had done, but there were two at Cadillac Escalade missing. Two of them, not one, but two, right? And so the CEO, the chairman of the board, He had a beautiful house in Rhode Island on a cliff walk. Who said they were from Rhode Island? I can't remember. You? In that cliff walk before, right? Those beautiful mansions there on the cliff walk. Unbelievable place. So I'm curious one day, because that's what I do, and I go on Google Earth and go look at this thing. And I looked at the person next to me and go, I just found where the Cadillac Escalade was. And they said, well, I go, look, it's right in this guy's driveway. It's in the CEO's driveway. It's sitting right here. I'm like, wow, it is. It, you know, obviously wasn't today. But yeah, sure enough. And so we traced it back and got him to admit, you know, it was in your driveway 6 months ago or 3 months ago, whatever it was. Where is it? He's like, oh, okay, it's over in the garage. Great. And people will lie. Drives me nuts when they lie, but they will lie all the time. All right, so what are the stages of an investigation? So we start with scoping, right? So we talked a little bit about there's an allegation, right? What is it that I'm looking at? What am I trying to get my arms around? That's how we scope something out, right? Then we move into what data should I be gathering to try and get my arms around what is this that I'm trying to do? How am I going to do an investigation? What's the data that I need to do that, right? And then I'm going to start doing some investigating, right? I might start doing, looking at some transactions and trying to identify if there are some anomalies or things that might indicate that this conduct occurred, right? I'm doing this quickly so we can get to the other stuff. And we're going to have all kinds of fun next week. And then also preliminary findings. Geez, you know what? I see a couple transactions that look a little odd here. It looks like revenue was recognized improperly. Could have been, not sure. A couple other ones seem okay, right? And it looks like the transactions where there is a problem look like this. And so why don't I focus on that for a moment, at least those kinds of transactions. Then what I might do is once I have some information, right? I'm not going to interview somebody, really, typically, until I have some information so I really have an understanding. Remember what I said earlier, if I'm trying to talk to somebody, I need to know the system as well as they do, I need to know the process as well as they do, I need to know what's there, right? So it does me no good whatsoever to interview Anna and say, Anna, geez, you know, tell me about that. And she's like, she's laughing, he knows nothing about this, I can lie all day long and he won't have a clue. But if I have documents, right, and I've got things that I know what the facts are, I ask you, well, wait, I'll let Anna dig herself a hole. And so I keep lying to me. That's fantastic. Yeah, keep lying. That's great. I had a case where it was controller at this company, and that was the one where a guy bought a boat for 150 grand, and he did all kinds of stuff. Massive fraud, actually. And what's that? A boat. A goat boat. I did have a case where somebody tried to say that one sheet was worth $500,000. So I did have that. Right. There we go. a boat. Sorry. I talked very fast because I'd be excited about this stuff. So I bought a boat, right, amongst other things. And what had happened was I was doing an interview with some of the lawyers in another room, and then other lawyers started this other conversation before I could get there because the other one went over time, right? And so now he thinks he's talking to a bunch of lawyers about accounting. And I come in the room late, and they don't introduce me, and he assumes that I am also a lawyer. So he starts saying all kinds of things that make no accounting sense whatsoever. So how did you pay this? Oh, you know, accounting, you just pay it. And nothing happens. You don't need an invoice or anything. And you don't put it in the system and blah, 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 all kinds of stupid things. And so I waited. And I just wait. And I let him dig himself a hole. And I wait. And I wait. And I wait. And I wait. So I waited a good 20 minutes and let him keep digging. And then finally I said, okay. And this is how you deal with people who lie, by the way. You don't just attack right away. And I said, okay. Gave a lot of answers here, and I appreciate you doing that. Let me just tell you my background real quickly. I've been doing forensic accounting for about 20 years, and I was at the SEC, and I ran that group there, and I prosecuted about 30 individuals, a number of different companies. And so do you have anything you want to change in what you just told me? The guy's face just drops. Well, I think I may have made a couple mistakes there. And, you know, I think, you know, I may have said something wrong. I'm not sure what I was thinking. And the guy actually admits with the fraud that he had done. But, so, anyway, I need to have the information to know, and sometimes I will play very stupid so that people think that I don't know what I'm doing. Anna knows that all the time. And then I'll do some additional investigating, because what somebody tells me, I get to validate that or show that they're lying to me sometimes and prove it out. And then I'll summarize it and say, okay, here's what we found. So we did all this data gathering, we did some investigating, we had some findings, some interviewing, finally pulled that all together, and I'm going to summarize it. Now, at the end, this may not stop. It may start back over again, because I found one issue that I identified and floated through, But during that summary, I found five of the things that need investigating. So it starts all over again, potentially. Okay? Anyone want to add to that at all? You good? Like, see, you want to say something?
No, well, so the project I'm on, again, now, I've been on it for a year, so that's why the long examples from it. It all started with an inventory problem. So this inventory, it came in, did the first part of the investigation, and so in this summary investigation part, we found, oh, there's actually a problem with revenue. We looked at revenue. That same time, found, I went up to here again, found there's a problem with the accounts receivable. Did again, problem with inventory, or accounts payable, problem with their fixed assets. And now hit every single, piece of their financial statement. So
you can go through this once, and it can take a week. Or you can go through this multiple times, it can take a year or more. It really depends. Our investigations last anywhere from a few days. The longest one I've been on is about a year and a half. And in that one, we sent 8 people to federal prison, $200 million of revenue recognition that they had to reverse as a funding. So. All right, building the information, right? So when we start talking to people, we don't automatically, if I think Anna did it, I don't start with Anna, right? Again, I need to know everything that she knows, or better, right? So if Anna's the CFO and I think that she did a revenue recognition scheme, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to start with doing some document analysis, look at the data we talked about, and go into the processes and all those different things. I might talk to some neutral third-party witnesses, people like the engineers I talked about, somebody outside the company potentially who may not have an axe to grind or skin in the game, so to speak. The engineers sitting there, as I talked about earlier, they're not involved in revenue recognition. They're just building product. They don't care, right? I might talk to some corroborative witnesses, people who knew about what happened in terms of just had, acknowledge the documentation and things like that. They're going to help me corroborate what happened, right? And then I'm going to start looking into some of the co-conspirators. Start talking to, the assistant controller. The assistant controller was involved. CFO told him to do it, do some interviews, told him or her to do it, figure that out. And then once I'm armed with all that information, now I'm going to talk to Anna, the CFO, right? Because now I'm armed with all that. I know that JP, the assistant controller, told me that Anna specifically told him to do this, right? We've got a fantastic case right now, fantastic FCPA case, right? We're dealing with the general counsel of the company in the United States. Over in India, there's alleged FCPA. Anyone know what FCPA is? Bribes, right? Foreign Corrupt Practices Act says that you, if you are a U.S.-based company, simplify it, U.S.-based company, you cannot go overseas and bribe people to get business, right? You can't bribe people generally, but let's say overseas and bribe people. In some countries, lots of bribes happen. And so you'll see all these cases out there, these FCPA cases, where it's exactly that. So long story short, general counsel company, we tell him, here's what we're going to do to investigate these allegations. He says, no. I don't want you doing that. I want you doing these 3 things instead of those 10 things. We're like, kind of weird. Why would you do that? Doesn't it really fit the bill of what you're asking us to do? He was such a jerk, this guy. On and on and on. Finally, lawyers push back on him and say, no, we really need to do this and get people to understand, the board to understand this. Yeah, you guys go do what you need to do. Don't worry about him. So we go do the work in India. And we find these transactions that look really odd. We find one in particular where there's a $2.5 million payment that was made directly to a government official in India to get some kind of permits. We say, this is really weird. What's going on? And then we see some emails coming to the U.S. to the CEO of the company and to a few other folks, right? So this is really weird now. Something's not right. So we interview somebody in India who's involved in the payment. What did he tell us? He says, well, I called. Somebody told us we had to pay this bribe. So I called the CEO and the general counsel last 6 months ago, and I told them. And they told me, the general counsel told me, well, pay it. But don't say I told you to pay it, if it ever comes up. And the CEO told them the same thing. Pay it. Get it done with. So now we have this investigation that the general counsel, who we've been working with, is the one who told the guy to make the payment. Right? Electronic evidence comes into play. So we now have to go and talk to the targets. We talked to the CEO and the general counsel. What do you think they say? I don't know what you do. That guy in India is crazy. I've never had such a conversation. Yeah, he sent me a couple invoices, and I didn't know it was a bribe. Does it say in there it's a bribe? It doesn't say that, does it? No, it doesn't. You're right. It doesn't say that at all. The general counsel says, I was never in such a conversation. I don't know what you're talking about, right? Electronic evidence coming into play. What do you think we do? What would we do in that case? Check emails, check his computer, see what's out there. This guy loved Apple Notes. Loved Apple Notes, I'll tell you. I found nothing better than 3 weeks ago on a Saturday when one of my team members says, Tony, I found something you might want to look at. And there's some notes in Apple Notes from the date of the supposed meeting that happened in this guy's Apple Notes that he took of the meeting that he says he wasn't at. That's interesting, right? So that makes it down again and say, hey, what's this? Well, I had a procedure that week and I had amnesia from that week. I'm not kidding you, this is back with the man tried to take off. I had amnesia from that week. I'm looking at my computer, are you kidding me? The CEO we talked to, he denied it. We told him we wanted him to come in again. And his lawyer called the next day and said, no, I think he's going to resign. So, that's a good story. Fun case. That's where JP comes in. All right, computer forensics. Do you want to go to this part? Is that you or me? We can share?
Yeah.
All right, well, introduce yourself first.
I'm JP Neon. I'm a manager in the forensic technology and discovery services practice. So I focus more on e-discovery primarily. But that's sort of the collection of electronic data, processing of data, and the review and production. And I don't just work with kind of county investigation work. Honestly, more often just deal with kind of lawyers and with litigation. I guess like I would start off by saying kind of digital evidence is really no different than any kind of evidence you would think of in Law and Order or whatever, you know. But in addition to there being a lot more of it, it's also in many ways a lot more fragile and susceptible to somebody altering it in some way. And so there's a very specific process that we use to find that data, make sure that we don't accidentally alter it in any fashion. We keep a very strict chain of custody with the idea that at some point a regulator or another party may be questioning exactly how we obtain the evidence. And we also have the ability using some very specific software tools to figure out whether somebody tried to delete some evidence or hide something from us. And I think Tony has some examples of where people, and there's obviously a lot of famous cases in the news where someone has tried to delete something from their cell phone or from their computer, et cetera, and there are ways of kind of seeing how people have tried to hide that. So that's kind of high.
Yep. All good points. I think we went over a number of these things earlier, but the cyber forensics we talked about, the e-discovery side of it mainly is making sure that we are capturing all the emails. We have fantastic tools, search tools, and so when we get involved in a fraud investigation, the search terms that we'll come up with is a whole catalog of terms, and so it might be things like revenue recognition fraud. We cater it to a specific example. In the case that I just talked about, it might be FCPA violation. It might be pay bribe. All kinds of terms like that to identify only the emails that we want to look at. There's all kinds of other tools that we use that are very sophisticated that I won't get into that make it much more efficient. But in general, that's some of the things that, that we're talking about.
Can we explain what this is?
I do. Is that, why don't we do that now? We'll go back. Let's do it. Go ahead.
So this is a forensic.
Feel free to come up too, by the way.
Includes two forensic laptops. There's a whole series of dongles. I did not bring them. We would generally have a brand new external hard drive for the collection, so you can't reuse any of the hard drives. But we kind of always have this expectation that it has to be fresh, no possibility of kind of contaminating from one collection to another.
So when we actually go on site, right, and JP has to go, and I call on one of my investigations, say, JP, I need you on site. I need you to image 20 people's laptops. This is what he brings.
Yeah, so, I mean, sometimes we do a target collection, but most frequently, like, a fraud situation, I think we most likely do a full forensic image. So you're, instead of kind of copying stuff from one place to another, you're kind of capturing a forensic image, which kind of, it's just a term of art, but it's like you're taking a picture of all of the data on the laptop or the cell or mobile device, whatever. And there's all these, you know, little wires, et cetera, in here for every type of cell phone, every type of tablet.
I'm gonna make him crazy, watch this.
Well, we have suspicions here. Our colleague Cameron, like, he sometimes will be like, oh, I need to see your phone real quick. Give me your phone. And then he'll borrow for a moment, and then I'm pretty sure he's looking at all of our text messages. But the idea is, you know, if you were adding, you know, to use Tony's example of the accountant is there, there's a bunch of lawyers, you know, he's also there, and he's like, oh, if it's cool, like, why don't you just, like, let us see your cell phone real quick, and we'll just take an image of it, and we'll process it, and take a look, you know, everyone will go through all of your information in a review tool, and if he was dumb enough to agree to that, like, you might also see, oh, he's deleted a lot of stuff off his phone in the last 30 days or something like that, and so there's, I mean, that's kind of the high-level explanation of what this tool is for.
If you take the example of the guy who's talked about the general counsel, so we had the image from him, an iPad, an iPhone, and he had his personal Apple laptop that he used for business, that he had linked into the business. He had a PC from the business that he used for business, and then he had three external hard drives. And so we had to go image all of those, right? So you have to have all the equipment. I can't be like, hey, I'll be right back. I'll come back in about an hour, because now he's taking the thing and throwing it in the trash, right, or doing something else with it. So, you know, we got to make sure that we have all the tools necessary. And what's the craziest thing that you've imaged before in terms of the type of device?
Crazy. I mean, the most famous case I know is I worked on the BP case. And
yeah.
Kurt Mix is a very famous engineer for BP who said something. I forget exactly what he said, but it was like, oh, there's only like 3,000 barrels going into the Gulf every hour, day, or whatever. He said that.
Yeah.
Told that to the SEC, I'm trying to CNBC or something.
Yeah.
But then on his cell phone, he was like, furiously texting his boss saying, like, holy crap, like, we're screwed, there's like 20,000 barrels every hour, so they imaged his phone, and
we've had cases, other cases where people had to have PlayStations imaged, things like that, gaming devices, because they put information there, all kinds of interesting things. Anyway.
So it's not necessarily hacking into another person's, like, computer, because, like you said, if they got it from the business, you legally have the right to go into. So,
yeah, you know, and most times they know. Yeah. Like, most times we'll tell them, we're taking your device and packaging it. Right? And then they're like, they're kind of looking at you like, okay, should I take this away? And they really don't have a say, right? They have to give it to us. So it's not often that we're just imaging something without letting somebody know we've done that. There are extreme circumstances where that has to happen. Companies do have tools where once you're actually logged into the system, they could actually download your information and image your drive. If they wanted to, but
I mean, so like I work probably 50% primarily on like a large defense contractor, and we mostly don't use these kits. We just do a remote collection where we remote into the employee's machine and do either a targeted collection, or in some cases we take like a full image of the entire laptop, entire workstation, and that's kind of preferable in some ways because then you don't have this kind of chain of custody piece to worry about. But that's not always something that. I would explain also kind of the point of the road kit, and it looks like very, you know, heavy duty or whatever. I mean, it really is about having a chain of custody that's ironclad, and like if a camera or somebody was to go out to a client site to do a collection, he couldn't check this on the airplane. He has to like zip tie it closed and keep it with him at all times. He needs a form filled out for any kind of, you know, if he gets back to the office and he has a hard drive in there and Tony wants to borrow it for a minute or something, you need to sign that form and kind of explain, like, I handed this off to Tony for an hour, he gave it back to me, and it's now like a secure evidence locker in our office. And that's kind of why.
If you think of the, right, why is that so important to you?
So I don't know what tampers with the evidence or anything like that.
Yeah. So that general counsel is an example. What's the first thing he's going to try and say, maybe? What did you guys do with that data? What did you guys put in my notes? I didn't do that. Right? And so that's why you have to be very careful. There's any hole there where someone gave it up for an hour, it gives him room to say, no, what happened during that hour? Maybe somebody put something there. It wasn't me. Right? And so that's why we have to be very cautious in everything that we do. So. Anyway, we'll show and tell for you. No, I refuse. I made you more nervous than I made JP.
I really did.
give like one example of how you do a chain of custody?
Yeah, bring your phone over here, we'll show you.
Sure.
You don't want to do that? Can
I
give an example?
We went out and did a collection at the client site,
yep.
And it brought back the data. And it's just, I mean, it's really as simple as, like, it's very contentious. There's multiple parties involved that are all kind of claiming, like, we haven't looked at the data correctly, or maybe, you know, we didn't collect the right time period, or we missed something, and there's questions about whether it was a complete snapshot of all the data there. So basically, as it's simple as, like, the person who's collecting it will fill out a form. We call it, like, an LTS 4 or something like that, and it just says, like, I was out at the client site in New London, Connecticut, whatever. This is who I collected from. This was the type of device they had. You know, they had a Lenovo laptop. This was the model. You know, this is what I took from the laptop. I got back to the office. I signed it into the evidence. I mean, we literally have like a little closet, essentially, that's like has a fireproof safe in it. And you kind of just, the collections person, technician, would just basically say, I put it into the evidence locker at this time. And if at any point, we took it out, and that's more likely where I would come into it. Like, you take it out to process it and put it into a review tool so that the attorneys could take a look at it, or the FBI team could take a look at it. I would then need to explain, like, I took it out of the evidence locker at this time. You know, this is why I took it out. I was running it through Nuix to put it into a review tool or something like that. And that's kind of does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure, you don't want to give up your phone?
Yeah.
All right, and we'll give you that just some examples. So this is you, unless you want this to be me, but you want me to do it?
No, I mean, I can. So, you know, the EDRM is kind of what they call the e-discovery circles or whatever. It's kind of the data identification, which data do you want to collect, and that would most often just be kind of a list of custodians, who are the relevant people that we need to get data from. I guess the exception to that might be, you know, shared drive or company's email archive or something like that. But kind of that first stage is just like more of a strategic stage where you're just deciding what's relevant.
Yeah, and that's important, and it will be important. We'll talk about this next week a little bit in a case study that we'll do, because you want to try and figure out who should I get the data from, right? If I've got a case again where, and as a CFO, JP's the assistant controller, a few other folks are involved, I don't want to go get everybody's emails, the entire accounting department, right? Because that takes a lot of time. I need to get what I really need to find, and if I find some information in it that says, okay, you know, JP is actually talking to, you know, somebody on the shipping dock about it, well, I might want to get that guy's email or that woman's emails as well. So we need to be very targeted when we do these things. So.
Yeah, so the next phase is the data collection phase, and that's, I think we've kind of already gone over it. I guess the other thought I would think crosses my mind that you kind of said before is oftentimes you're dealing with not in the fraud context, but some of these other things that we're doing, it's just kind of like, is a best practice being followed? You know, are they using some sort of forensic data collection process? Like, who collected it? Is there an audit trail around, like, how it was done? And we're always kind of thinking that, you know, down the line, a regulator may be involved, or there may be scrutiny from a court or something like that. So you're kind of always being proactive in that phase to just make sure you're following kind of industry best practices in terms of how you're collecting data. And then the next phase, I think this is a little different than how I would title it, but the processing phase or kind of data culling phase is sort of how I would think of it, where once you have that data, you're now kind of trying to find the needle in the haystack, essentially, or you're at very least trying to see kind of what are the anomalies, what are the trends, like how do I find the documents or emails that I'm concerned about. So, you know, we have a number of tools that can process very large amounts of what we would call unstructured data. So that would be things like emails and Word documents and stuff that are in no particular format to be searched en masse in some sort of tool. So they can kind of take all that loose information and put it into like a single format that you can search at once and repeatedly.
So an example of that is kind of what we were saying earlier with emails. So back in the day, maybe when Tony was a little bit younger, they used to have to go through every single email. So now there's tools where, you know, if it's a revenue recognition problem, there's keywords in there. So maybe revenue, even just auditors, maybe the auditing firm's name, things like that, and kind of different phrases that they'll, keywords, they'll run through all these emails to pick out which one has a hit. So now let's focus on those, because that will probably contain something that would be of interest to us.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds very simple, but it can, there's some really incredible tools, and become much better than you ever wanted to at kind of understanding, like, revenue within three of recognition will give you, like, a much more targeted set of documents than just, like, revenue recognition. Like, any document that has revenue and recognition, it may give you a bunch of junk that may take, like, 2 or 3 days to look through, and especially, like, on the tight timelines that we're dealing with, that can make a big difference. We also use tools that they will deduplicate the documents, so if you have, like, a big, think about if we were all in the same office, there might be a number of emails where everyone at this table is copied on the same email. Do we want to look at it 4 times or 1 time? And there's ways to kind of also decide, do we want to look at each reply back and forth individually, or do we want to just see the last email in the chain that has the most inclusive of all other emails in that chain? So there's, they sound sort of boring and minor in, as I'm explaining them right now, but, you know, in when you magnify that times, you know, tens of thousands of documents or emails, it can make a huge difference in terms of the time required to find that needle in a haystack. And that's kind of the observations, et cetera, are really not my.
That's fine. Yeah, we don't need to get into that more, but we'll give some examples. Where is the evidence? We talked about this, all kinds of different places. Mac time capsule is a good example. Anywhere where data is stored, really, you know, that someone may be using. And we've used it for various kinds of cases, whether it's you might not be involved in this one, it was my prior firm, a sexual crime type case where stuff was being kept on a Sony PlayStation, certain tapes and videos and things, and all kinds of various cases, whether business related or not. So,
another interesting one that's come up, we had a client that was where they had like a software developer that was using GitHub, which is, you know, like a third-party hosted forum, essentially, where people are talking about coding and kind of sharing information. So there's kind of a challenge there, but we found kind of an additional data source outside of the enterprise where one of their developers was sharing, like, stuff that he was being paid by the company to develop on, like, a public forum and sharing with other developers. So.
What would that be kind of theft of that we talked about earlier?
We can tell when someone's connected a thumb drive to something, when someone's downloaded information from a computer and put it onto a device, we can typically tell that. Well, I think we've got an example of that somewhere here. So oftentimes, especially with intellectual property cases, somebody leaves a company and you see that, geez, lo and behold, you left the company and you say that you didn't take this key information, but we can see that your company laptop, there was a thumb drive attached to it, and, you know, 10 gigs of information were taken with that thumb drive. Isn't that interesting? And we can see which files were taken often, oftentimes as well. So anyway, all kinds of different devices. Just going through in the interest of time here to make sure we get through everything. So this is what our lab looks like. This is JP, where JP works. There are all kinds of government regulations, as we talked about. Chain of custody is very important. So we need biometrics in the form of fingerprint access to get into the lab. So even within our own office, so imagine I've got my badge that gets me into the building, right? So I got to get into the building, and I got to use this badge again to get into our space in general, to the floor that I'm on, the 15th floor, 200 Clarendon Street. Nobody else can do it without the badge. And then once I get on my floor, I've got to try and go to the lab. And to get in the lab, you need first an ID that actually is coded to work with the lab to get in the first door, and the second door has biometrics on it. So it's kind of interesting. I run the group of about 45 people. I can't get in the lab. Isn't that funny how that works? So they have a space that they can go hide from me very easily and play their tricks. So anyway, I think you guys want to say about this slide, but.
No, I mean, this was I think it's all kind of making it sound grander than it is in some ways. It's just, you know, the evidence locker, essentially, is a controlled area where we are sure that it's also, like, you know, fireproof and blah, blah, blah.
I'm trying to, you know, sell you a 007. Help me out here, okay? exclusive access continued.
Well, there is the accounting movie now.
There is the accounting movie.
It's exactly like that.
Yeah, it was going to be fantastic if they put Ben Affleck in it. I'm really psyched about that. Ben Affleck as an accountant is great. All right. Subject matters? You want me to do this? That's fine.
I don't know about it.
Yeah, we can.
From my perspective, I mean, from the discovery perspective, it's kind of anything and everything, honestly, where there's data. I guess, like, from my perspective, a lot of times they're hiring us to do some of this stuff when there's kind of an international component, or, you know, they need somebody to kind of be ready for a regulator. Not every litigation case necessarily requires this level of thoroughness, but that's generally what we see.
Fair. Yeah, and we won't go through every example. I'm trying to make sure that we actually get you out of here at 8 o'clock, even though we started late. So, but you can see a number of kinds of cases here. And we talked about things like, you know, procurement fraud is a type of act, occupational fraud, money laundering is a whole other thing, investigations we use it for, intellectual property stuff you heard us talk about, and some others. So. No, I won't go into it. I'll be good. I had something I was going to go into, and I'm not going to waste your time. Case example number one. So this is something that I worked on at one of my at my prior firm, actually. And this one was pretty public, and so you have to be very careful. And so there are public records laws that say that if you are a public official in Massachusetts, then you actually cannot delete emails, effectively. Right? So if you have your work computer, you're not supposed to be destroying emails that are on there, because someone might ask for access to it, because you might be talking about some new... I don't know, there's a new building going out in the city or something like that, right? So it was an accusation that somebody that worked for Mayor Menino at the time violated the public records law and deleted a ton of emails, right? A ton is a very technical term, of course. And so they hired my firm to go in and try and identify, the city did, because now people were making accusations against the city of Boston, to find out were things deleted, and if they were, could we recover them? So they could show that there wasn't any intent behind it, right? So in that case, we did an analysis of the hard drives. We also looked at some of the backup systems that they had within the city servers, et cetera, to try and recover thousands of emails that they had, right? And so to do that, we had to get into, I won't bore you with it, but Outlook has different types of files called OSTs and PSTs, and we had to look at the various files. When you delete something, right, you think it's gone? Not really, right? So people do this all the time. They think they deleted something. In the case that I just talked about a minute ago, one of the things that we also look for is to see if you tried to put any type of a wiping software on your system. The general counsel that I talked about searched for different types of wiping software in Google. So we have the 10 different searches that he did on it. We have that from his system. And then we have what he downloaded to try and wipe his system as well. So we have built all kinds of evidence to show, not only did you have bad evidence on your computer, but you tried to wipe it, and then you were dumb because you bought the wrong stuff, and you still didn't wipe it right, and we still found it. So that's the analysis that we want to do. It's called the stupidity analysis. Technical term again. So in this case, it's a bit different. We were just trying to recover things for the city to show that there wasn't any intent or time behind what the person was deleting, and if there was sensitive information, then you could figure out what it was, right? Which saved Mayor Menino quite a few bit of grief. The individual, I think, did get fired at the end of the day, because even though it was just stupid, it's something they shouldn't have been doing. But we were able to help them identify where the information was. And I'm not going to belabor it, just in the essence of time. Okay? The next one, this is a JP show for the next one.
This isn't really accounting related, but I just thought it was an interesting case that I had in the last year where our client was a large defense contractor. They had bought another company and were engaged in litigation. I don't really remember what the substantive basis of the case was, but one of the employees of our client was fired in the meantime since the case started. We kind of have a standard process by which we call each custodian with the lawyer on the phone. We kind of perform a collection of their workstation. In this guy's case, we had like his former boss, basically, so we interviewed. And in the interview, it came up, this work on his computer may be covered by the China state secrets law, which the lawyer freaked out and then was like, end the call, like put this on hold. One of the penalties for moving data that's protected by this law out of China is imprisonment or death. So, and the collections technician was like, oh my God, I don't want to have anything to do with this. But you know, there was a case going on in New York, and we needed to get the data back and reviewed by counsel in the United States. So basically, we reached out to our counterparts in the Hong Kong and Shanghai UI offices. We actually ended up performing the collections, but we then handed off the data to the Shanghai office. It was the laws are so strict that any non-People's Republic of China citizen or whatever cannot access the data at any point before it's cleared. So the Hong Kong office could not handle it. It had to be only people in Shanghai. They contracted with a People's Republic of China law firm. They performed processing, review, etc. of all the emails from the guys, the employees' workstation. They redacted some of the less sensitive but still somewhat sensitive information from emails, and redactions where they apply a black box over any information that would be sensitive. They kind of pulled back any emails that were, we couldn't see them. They couldn't leave China, apparently. And then finally, they put the data into a format that could be transferred to us and sent it to us via a secure file transfer protocol, SFTP. And then we, had our U.S. attorney review that and produce the relevant documents to the other side. But it was, pretty incredible process. It took about a week, and it's pretty cool.
One of the reasons, for this very reason, we have labs all over the world. So if we've got data privacy issues in the UK, as an example, we have a lab in the UK, so we're not worrying about us going over and taking it out of the country and getting ourselves into trouble. So if we do the work there, permitted, you're good. It's when you transfer stuff out of a country sometimes where you get yourself into all kinds of trouble. So we also make sure that we work with lawyers that we're working with so they can tell us all the data privacy rules. And then we try and know those rules obviously very well internally as well, but very important that you know those things down. All right. Case number 3 was a divorce matter. Divorce. Fun case. In this case, actually, what we call spoliation of evidence, the husband tried to destroy evidence that was relevant to a legal proceeding that we were in. So in this case, they owned a horse racing business. The guy was the number one owner of racehorses in the country. So he owned the most racehorses in the country. And he also owned a mortgage business, and he was trying to hide money to say that he didn't have any money so the spouse wouldn't get any. So in the case, we had to ask for data from him, from his computer, his laptop, etc. Actually, in this one, there were two things. There was both a laptop and then a Dell workstation. So he's old school, apparently. What he did was he actually tried to, tried to wipe the system. We were able to go in and actually identify that he put in a new hard drive at the end of the day. So when you go in, you can see that there was another hard drive being used initially. And then a new one showed up. So we tried to hide the original drive on us. We could also do some analysis to find out that, again, the Windows operating system was reinstalled. And then we could also see that there were a number of external devices that were attached after he went through and did the reinstallation of the operating system. And we could also do a link file analysis to see that certain types of files were downloaded to those hard drives that were attached to the system, and that those included the financial spreadsheets that we were looking for that identified what the business was worth and all those other things. So imagine if you're in court and you're that individual, and I've got JP on the stand, right, saying, we couldn't find the information because the individual wouldn't give it to us. However, we looked at his system, and here are all the things he did to try to hide the data from us, and here is the specific data that he tried to hide from us, which is the stuff that he says he didn't have in the first place, right? So that type of chain and that type of evidence is extremely important in what we do in destroying somebody's credibility sometimes. Not that I'm always trying to destroy credibility, but that seems like a commonality here that you're talking about. All right?
Who never wants to delete anything ever again?
Delete it well.
Yeah, just be good at it.
Take that hard drive, put it in some salt water, run over it a few times, and maybe, just maybe, you want to see what
you have. Apple.
What's that?
Unless you have an Apple.
Unless you have an Apple
server.
Yeah. And buy a Samsung Galaxy Note 7 if you do, and do that thing for All right, yeah, it's me or you. That me? All right. You're like, no. Data analysis, right? So we talked about data analytics a bit, right, and how efficient it makes things. So what we're trying to do every time
we get involved in a matter is how do we make this more efficient? And so what I'll try and do is, you know, typically when somebody's doing some type of financial fraud, right, for a minute we're talking about financial reporting, right, not about somebody just stealing money. There's got to be a driver behind it, right? You can use it for this example, frankly, or you can use it for, who's heard of like Wells Fargo? All the things that are going on. Anybody get a free credit card they didn't know about? No? You get that? Right? Wells Fargo's a good example, right? People were being incentivized. Guaranteed, I'm not involved in the case. There are all kinds of reports that went out that said, you need to open this many accounts. You know, we have a target for credit card accounts, we have a target for this, we have a target for that. All kinds of management reports internally saying, drive, 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 right? So what I want to do is test the performance metrics that they're focusing on, right? So what's going to show me what kind of bad behaviors might be driven by those management reports, right? Whether it's Wells Fargo or whether it's a case where it's just an accounting fraud, right? So I might try and look at internally what metrics were they reporting on and how can I see if there are anomalies in those metrics? And I'll give you an example in a minute. I might look at external metrics, right? If I'm trying to look at a bank like Wells Fargo, I might look at their competitor, Capital One, and say, geez, why is it that Wells Fargo, you know, I can see the trend line here where their sales of their credit cards, you know, goes up like this, and yet Capital One kind of stays steady down here. Why is that? Why is there a gap there? Is it just that Wells Fargo is that much better? Or are they just issuing more credit cards if something's wrong, right? Where's the anomaly there? You know, it doesn't tell you that there's a problem, but it tells you that there's something that you want to look at. Where am I going to pinpoint, right? Whether that's a date, time frame that you're looking at, or a specific instance, right?
Another example. Another example from our recent fraud case I was helping out with was we wanted to see email sent and received dates. Is there any spike in the communication? Was there a certain period of time where it suddenly fell flat and it seemed like we didn't get all the, we had some doubts about how it was collected because we didn't collect it.
Yep.
But similarly, we wanted to know, like, there were some very key times where we're kind of like, is there a spike? Or are we emailing each other more during that time?
Yep.
And similarly, we looked at kind of the email subject line to kind of say two of the key executives were infamous for writing do not forward and block letters in the subject line. So we wanted to be like, where are all those emails? Can we look at those real quick and see where they're from?
Yep.
And we saw in some cases they were from, you know, they were garbage. They were from, like, you know, the guy's personal stockbroker or whatever. But in other cases, that quickly kind of was the something that did not pass the smell test and kind of allowed us to sort of say, okay, what else is similar to this in the system?
So a little anomaly tells that there might be a problem, something worth digging into more on, like in JP's instance, right? So from that, we can figure out what kind of a targeted analysis do I want to do to get my arms around that, right? Which can lead to all kinds of additional testing, to follow up on those anomalies, et cetera, et cetera. And I will say, sometimes, I say it right here, simple frauds, simple analysis, and I'll show you a good example of that, okay? Fact pattern, and I'll do this quickly. I am going to go probably 5 minutes over, I just warned you, I'm going to take some of my time back that I lost on the front end. I'll try not to do more than that, because I know you guys are trying to get on to the next thing, and studying, right? Sure. Studying to do? All right. So this is an interesting one, and it's very interesting because it was a healthcare facility that I had to go to, and it was actually a crystal meth rehab facility. That was a lot of fun, let me tell you. Hanging out at a crystal meth rehab facility with people running around. That was fun. We actually had to go on site most of our investigations, so we had to see these things. But there was a controller there that was fired because of performance-related issues. He had been there from January 2009 to July 2011, important, and I'm going to show you why. And then when they started looking at some of the work that he had done, they saw some weird entries around accounts receivable write-offs in Q2 2011, which would be right around the time frame he left, right before he left. Right? The company reported their revenue metrics to headquarters, because there was a much number of different healthcare facilities, this is one facility out of many, based on the revenue by healthcare program and expenses for various financial statements. The company also reported expense metrics to headquarters based on expenses by financial statement category, right? So our task in that case is determine whether the errors were intentional or unintentional, who knew their errors, and identify any other erroneous entries and determine whether anybody else was involved. Because this guy left, things were found, we're pretty sure we know who did, right? All right, so that's what we're trying to figure out. So, simple case, simple analysis. One of the things we looked at was accrued expenses, right? So they have all these accruals that should have been taking place. And this is the debit side, so mind you, this is the expense side of it, right? Not the liability side of it. And what should have happened here is your accrued expenses really should have a debit balance, right? You should have a positive balance, not a negative, would be a credit here, okay? And so, remember what I said, January 2009, this individual took over, right? So when we put this chart together, this is a real chart from a real case, by the way, we looked at it and said, geez, look at this, their accrued expenses were about $50,000. That month after this person took over, it went negative slightly, and then it stayed zero for a while. And then it went negative, and went more negative, stayed there for a while, and then went really negative, right? And then, remember I said he left in July 2011? Wow, look what happened. All of a sudden, they went back to about the same amount of accrued expenses they had before, right? So one, what does this tell me? Not one, but what does this tell me? What's that? Probably intentional, right? What else does it tell me?
What does the time frame tell you?
Do I need to worry about periods that were before this, you think?
No.
Why?
Started right when he started.
Right? Yeah. Right? So it's pretty clear what happened. And what period do you think I should probably look at? Right, I might want to check here. I might want to check here because I see big changes. I definitely want to check here to see what happened. Right, and then I will see when it started to come back in. I probably want to see that too. Right, so it starts to tell me a couple things. One, yeah, it's all during his time frame. That's interesting, right? Two, there are certain periods where I can test to see exactly what he is doing. So what was his fraud? Because it might go over other accounts, right? And then, you know, I can see three, that it's limited to here and when he left. Now, there's a weird thing that happens here in August, even though he left, so somebody else took the company that was doing things as well. Because why did he go back down, right? So I got to figure that out now. Leaves me guessing a little bit, okay? We also looked at the revenue side and said, okay, I had this run for every type of revenue. So this was a specific type of patient revenue that was coming through the books. And the yellow line here is the budget. So they had a budget saying, here's what revenue is going to be by period over this time frame. Okay? And then here, the gray shows me what actually happened. Right? Now, miraculously, you know, they're doing all right here, fine. Right? Fine. I started January 2009. Gee, I wonder why I did that. When he was involved. But then suddenly, here, you know, target about $60,000-$70,000 of revenue, and they had $125,000 or so. What's going on there? I don't know. Need to look at that. Big gap here, huge gap here. I mean, look at that. They had from $100,000 to almost $225,000 of revenue during that month, and then here it just skyrockets to over $250,000 during that month. Right? Something's going on here. What's the deal? Right? And look. Well, he left, and look what happens. The budget it falls below budget. Isn't that amazing, right? Probably another thing. So from that, I say, okay, what other revenue programs do I want to look at? So there's another program, revenues, another line of revenues that I wanted to flow through. And look at this one. I've got a budget of about $5,000 a month or less of revenue coming through, and in 1 month, he's got almost $40,000 of revenue. Something's wrong here, right? And I want to focus on this to understand, there we go, what happened. Okay? And again, you can see that it all stops once he leaves. Okay? So, in this case, what I did was, I sat down with the individual, I interviewed him, and I remember I met him at a law firm. I was in Tennessee at the time, it was a facility in Tennessee. And I sit down at a table, and I did everything that I talked about earlier with you guys. I walked through all these different things. I didn't walk through the reports, but I walked through. All right, tell me who is it that actually goes and books the revenue? Well, I do that. Okay. Anybody else involved in the process? Nope, just me. Okay. Anybody else would touch those things? Nope. Okay. And how's it booked? Well, it's on a spreadsheet. Okay, great. On a spreadsheet. And how's it done? Well, a patient comes in, it's a certain code that we use, and
for that code is a set amount of revenue, and that's how we book it. And I just put a spreadsheet together, and I summarize it up, and it's fine. Okay, okay. So you need all that. So I go through, and this is actually the spreadsheet. Take this, ignore this for a minute. This is a spreadsheet where they did revenue. And what this is that it's a patient account number. And then here is a code that tells you the kind of procedure, a little different. And then this is the rate that they get for that procedure, per doing that specific procedure. So this is the rate that was on the spreadsheet where revenue is calculated. So in that, all I can see, this isn't there, all I can see is this procedure done for that account number for that patient, and that's $324 that got charged to that patient, right? So what do I do to test that? I look at it and I say, okay, let me go and look at the contracts with the different healthcare insurers to see how much you're supposed to pay for it. When I go in, I can see that the rate that the healthcare insurer actually said they'll pay is $114, right? Ignore this for a minute, right? That's weird. Why does it say $324? So then I went in and I said, let me look at this spreadsheet some more. And we did a little bit of work here to expand what was actually in the cell. So what actually was written in the cell was 114 plus 210. Right, so literally somebody just went in and punched in the additional 210 on every single line, right? So that's how they get 324. So I first went through it without this with them. I said, here, okay, went through, you're the only one that does, yep, blah, 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 on and on and on. Okay, let me explain something to me. And I showed him, I said, here's the contract with the insurer. It says the rate's 114. Yep, that's right, it's 114, yep. Why does it say 324? I don't know what that is. Somebody must have made a mistake. Well, didn't you say you're the only one that does that? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I must have made, I don't make mistakes. It wasn't me. Okay. And then I go in, I say, well, let's go back to this. It's actually somebody wrote 114 plus 210. Well, I don't know who did that. Well, didn't you say you're the only one that does the sheet? I gotta go to the bathroom. Might as well go to the bathroom. Right. And literally, that's what he did. He's like, I go to the bathroom, and he left and never came back. So it was the most amazing story, and you're like, all right, you're a bad person. So that's how we actually built this case, is to go through in that methodology to say, here are analytics that tell me where I need to look. Once I did that, we could actually dig into, here's this revenue spreadsheet and the areas I need to look at. You don't see the time frame here, but I can tell you what the time frame was. And then we got, walked him through it and basically got him to show that he was not credible and that he was the only person involved at the end of the day. So that's it. Class one. Questions? You gotta have some questions. Because everybody, at the end of every class, when somebody's about to get out, somebody raises their hand and it makes everybody angry. It's gotta be something. All right?
Martin, you just have a question.
All right. No questions at all. Anyone? All right, cool. Next week, we'll have a case study, so we're going to force you to be interactive. Do you have a question? No? You good? All right. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
We'll see you in-